Okay, we're going to solve a system of differential equations here. So we have a two-dimensional system. We've got two equations, two dependent variables. X and Y are dependent variables. Notice that on the right-hand side here, it's a homogeneous system. I have no functions of t over here, just a function of t terms. And also notice that the coefficient functions for my dependent variables are all constants. So this is the kind of differential equation, system of differential equations that we can use eigenvalues and eigenvectors to solve. So one of the things that you will want to do when you do that is rewrite this system in matrix notation. The more of these you do, the more comfortable you should get going back and forth between the system and the matrix notation. But at first, there's maybe a few details to kind of pay attention to. So I'm going to write these derivative terms on the left-hand side here as a vector. So this is an x vector that represents x and y. And I want the derivative with respect to t of that. So I could write d dt of that x vector, or I'm just going to write x prime is equal to. And then my coefficients here, 9, 5, negative 6, negative 2, and then times the x vector. And again, that x vector, we did this in class notes, but that x vector represents the vector of all the variables here, x and y in this case. Okay, so there is our system written in matrix notation. I also do have some initial values here, which I'll also put into matrix notation. So I can think about my x vector of 0. Let's see here, I'll just write this below. X of 0 equals, and then I want my variables written here in a 2x1 vector, so 1 and 0. Okay, so this is just rewriting the same problem in some different notation. So I haven't really solved it yet, but I'm going to use eigenvalues and eigenvectors to solve this. A couple of other kind of just concept ideas. Remember, it's a two-dimensional system, so I need two linearly independent solutions in order to build the general solution. So that's what I'm really after here, two linearly independent solutions to form that basis for the solution space. So we looked at in class why this works, but the basic idea is that if you can find your eigenvalues and then an eigenvector that forms the basis for the null space for that eigenvalue, that you can then build your linearly independent solutions for your system. So I'm going to start by finding my eigenvalues of my coefficient matrix. So I'm going to write my A minus lambda I. So I'm subtracting lambdas on the main diagonal. And then you may know different ways to find your eigenvalues. Whatever method you know that's a correct method is fine. I'm going to use what we talked about in class, which is the determinant of this matrix set equal to 0 gives you your eigenvalues. Be careful with your signs here. Any little mistake at this step is going to mess up all the rest of your work here. So just being careful about, here I have a plus 30 from the minus negative 30 when I take this product. And then when I solve this, I'm going to have to FOIL this out. And so again, there's, you know, we want to be careful with your signs there. So I usually do it with the lambda terms first. So minus lambda times minus lambda is lambda squared. And then I'll have a couple of lambda terms. I'll have a minus 9 lambda and a plus 2 lambda. So minus 7 lambda. And then the constant term, I'll have a minus 18 plus 30. So plus 12. So that's just very basic algebra, which you all have known how to do for a very long time. But if you mess anything up here, it's going to send the problem off in a crazy direction that may not even make any sense in terms of what's working with the initial values or something here. So this is a place to just pause for a second and make sure that your algebra is correct. All right, once you've paused and made sure your algebra is correct though, then you just need to solve this quadratic equation. So factor or use quadratic formula. This one factors pretty easily, set into lambda minus 3 times lambda minus 4. And so you'll get lambda equals 3 or lambda equals 4 for your two solutions for that. Okay, so then for each of these lambda values, I'm going to find the eigenspace that goes with each of these eigenvalues. So I really am going to kind of do two separate little problems here and then put those together to form my general solution. All right, so we're going to have 4, lambda equals 3, and I'll do some work here, and then I'll do some other work for lambda equals 4, and I'll kind of put all that together for my general solution. All right, so for lambda equals 3, I'm going to put in my 3 for my A minus lambda I matrix, A minus 3I. I'll just write lambda here, but I'm putting in lambda equals 3. Okay, and again, be careful with your subtraction here. There's a lot of subtraction in these problems, so just being careful with all of your signs. All right, so when we do that, what I'm looking for is a basis for the null space of this matrix. So for this first one, I'm going to maybe write out a little bit more steps than I will for some later problems here. But I'm looking for the null space for this matrix. So that would be the set of all 2x1 vectors. I'm not going to use x and y since I have x and y meaning something else here in the problem. So I'll just use a and b. So the set of all 2x1 vectors, such that this matrix times that vector equals the zero vector. That's the definition of null space. So I'm not going to write that out every time, because every time you're going to end up with basically the same idea here, that you're looking for the vectors such that when you multiply them times this matrix, you get zeros for your solutions there. So you end up with a system of equations. And usually I just go straight from this matrix to the system of equations that you would get from this. So when you do the matrix multiplication here, you're going to have 6a plus 5b equals 0. And then minus 6a minus 5b equals 0. Okay, so with an eigenvalue of multiplicity 1, I should expect an eigenspace here of multiplicity 1 or of dimension 1 or less. You'll notice here that I have the same equation twice. So that means that I have a free variable here, a one-dimensional null space. So really any one non-zero vector AB that satisfies this system of equations is a basis for this null space. So I'm really just looking for a single vector AB that satisfies this, that's not the zero vector, right? Obviously the zero vector makes this true. But I need a basis, and that zero vector is not going to be a basis for this null space. So I'm just choosing A and B values that make this true. This is a place, though, where I find a lot of students make a mistake, because they just go too fast for this part. So be careful about this. I usually take one of the equations and move a term to the other side. Remember, this is always going to be zero because it's about a null space. So take one of the equations and move a term to the other side. So 6a equals negative 5b. And then you need to choose a and b values that make this equation true. So I would look at this and say, well, it's easy to make both sides of the equation equal to 30. Right, 6 and 5 both go into 30. So if I make both sides of the equation 30, that's an easy choice for my A and my B. So A would be 5, and B would be negative 6. It's very common for students to put the wrong numbers or the wrong signs in the wrong places here. So just think through that a little bit. You all know how to multiply and whatever. So this is a basis vector for this null space. And so part of what we talked about in class, went through some of the theory, tells you that then one of your solutions to the differential equation, one of your basis function solutions for the system of differential equations, is this eigenvector times e to the lambda t. So this will give us one of our solutions that we need. I'll just write it up here, x1 equals my eigenvector. And remember, any non-zero scalar multiple of this vector would work. So I might have 5, negative 6, and you might have 10, negative 12, or negative 5, positive 6. Any non-zero scalar multiple of that vector would work. So eigenvector times e to the lambda t, e to the 3t. Okay, so I'm going to circle that. It's not my answer, but I'm going to need that to build my answer. So there is one of my linearly independent solutions. And you can verify that that does satisfy this system of differential equations. And then I need to do basically the same thing here for lambda equals 4. I'm going to write out a little bit less steps here and kind of skip this middle part and go right to the system. But I need to put in my lambda equals 4 into the A minus lambda I matrix. So being careful with this. Okay, what I'm looking for is a basis for the null space for that matrix. So this is the idea, but I'll have this matrix I'm working with now. So I'll get this system of equations. So I'm going to go straight to that system of equations. So it'll be 5a plus 5b equals 0, and minus 6a minus 6b equals 0. Again, that's the same equation twice. You should expect that. If it's not, you should go back and check your work. You probably have a mistake somewhere. Okay, so same equation twice. So I just need a non-zero vector, AB, that satisfies this system of equations. So again, this isn't hard, but it's a place where I a lot of times see students make a mistake. So I would just take one of these equations, move a term to the other side, maybe divide through by 5 or 6, and you'll get A equals negative B. So just so the A and B are opposite signs. Okay, so for example, I could choose 1, negative 1, or negative 1, 1. If you're doing homework from the textbook or from my math lab, it often, when it shows you an answer, will choose that so that the first entry is positive. Really, any non-zero scalar multiple would work. The first entry does not have to be positive. But that's just kind of a way that it often chooses that, just for convenience. So not necessary, just a choice to be made. All right, but once I find an eigenvector there, then this vector times e to the 4t will give me a second solution to the system of differential equations. So there's my second one. These are linearly independent because I have different lambda values here. They will be linearly independent. You can verify that by using Oronskian or the definition of linear independence. And so from there, though, I can then write my general solution. I'm going to write it in matrix notation here. So my solution is going to be x equals c1 times one of these. Plus C2 times the other one. That's not quite my answer on this problem, though. We do have a pair of initial conditions. So I can go ahead and find my C1 and C2 values. I'm going to use my initial condition to do that. So I'm going to be putting in T equals 0. So that will make e to the 0, this part will be 1, and this part will be 1. And then in place of x, I will have the output there. So I'll have 1, 0 equals c1 times 5, negative 6, plus c2 times 1, negative 1. So you've got a little system of equations here. This one's pretty easy to solve by hand. You can use the matrix format for that, or you can rewrite that as a system of equations. This top row would give you 1 equals 5c1 plus c2. And the bottom row would give you 0 equals negative 6c1 minus c2. When you put it in this form, you can see you can add those equations together and the c2 terms drop out, and that gives you your c1 value. Once you find your C1 value, then it's pretty easy to find your C2 value. So C1 is negative 1, and then C2 will be 6. Okay, so I've done all the work here. I just need to put it all together. I'm about out of space here, so maybe I'll put it over here. But I need to write down the particular solution for the differential equation. So let's go ahead and do that over here. So I'm going to have x equals c1 was negative 1 times my vector 5, negative 6, e to the 3t, plus c2 was 6 times my vector here, 1, negative 1, e to the 4t. So there is my solution written in vector notation. Notice that the original system was written in kind of a system of equations notation, not in vector notation. So you could certainly convert this back to that form and rewrite your answer like that. When you do my math lab homework, please pay attention to how it asks you to write your answer. When you're doing written homework for me, I usually don't care what form you put your answer in as long as it's a correct form. So this would be perfectly fine, or you can convert this back to being in terms of x equals and y equals like our original differential equation was. All right, we're going to look in some later videos at what happens if you get repeated eigenvalues. Here I got distinct real eigenvalues, but there are situations where you get repeated eigenvalues or where you get non-real eigenvalues. So we'll look at those in some later videos.